You have to have toughness. You got to be tougher than everybody that we play. It's going to be difficult. Everybody here has got to have a lot of mental toughness.
Everybody, to another edition of the Nick Saban Show, brought to you by Truck Works, along with the head coach of the Crimson Tide. I'm Chris Stewart. Coach, congratulations. Amazing 20-19 win here in Austin.
Yeah, it was pretty amazing. You got to give our players a lot of credit for the resiliency they showed in the game to play the way they did late in third quarter and in the fourth quarter to make the drives that they made. Bryce was fantastic. But, you know, we didn't really play Alabama football today. You know, lots of penalties, lots of mental errors, didn't control the line of scrimmage like we need to on either side of the ball. So, you know, there's a lot of things to learn from this. And one thing our players got to know is one of the toughest things from a coaching standpoint is when you don't play well and you win. Because then players don't think we got to do anything different. But I hope our players have enough maturity to know that there's a lot to be learned from what we did today and how we played. Because this is the same atmosphere we're going to play in all the other SEC games that we play on the road. So we got to be able to execute and do things the right way.
I asked you on radio before this game what you learned from the first game against Utah State. Did you learn something about resiliency from your team in this game today?
Yeah, well, that's what I meant when I said in the beginning, you can't fault them for, you know, the perseverance that they showed, the adversity they overcame to, you know, win the game in the fourth quarter and make the plays that they needed to make. And I'm proud of them for that.
Right.
But if we're going to be the team that we could be, then we're going to have to play better one play at a time for 60 minutes in a game.
All right, Coach, let's get into the first half highlights.
Bryce Young, play action to Gibbs, looking to his right, dumps it to Gibbs out of the backfield, makes a man miss, 30, 35, 40, first down 40, 45, tripped up as he gets to midfield, they get the snap off in time, looking with time across the middle, catch made, first down, Prentice with the grab, Alabama inside the Texas 35, the middle of the field, the hold from Burnham, the kick is up, it appears to have enough leg, it is up, and it is good, 52 yards, Will Riker. 52-yard field goal from Riker, the only point so far. Texas swings it out left side, cut back 10, 10, and now down inside the 9-yard line. The 16, a 26-yard try, the kick is up, the kick is good, and we are tied at 3 apiece. Gibbs, who stays left, and McClellan in the backfield. He gets the handoff, goes right side, cuts it up, 20, 25, 30, foot race, 40, across midfield, 45, 40, forget catching him, 20, 15, 10, 5, touchdown, Alabama. The Tide rolls on an 81-yard touchdown run from Jace McClellan, and Bama quickly goes back. So much. Malachi Moore checks in to replace Helms in the defensive secondary. Play action again, looking deep. Got a man down there in coverage and not able to get there for the Crimson Tide. Devontae Smith and Xavier Worthy makes the grab. That receiver on the left to the right side. He'll roll left, busted play, looking, throwing, heaves it to the back of the end zone, incomplete. And Ewers is not getting up. I think they're going to call to Robinson, trying to get left. He bounces outside and into the end zone for a Texas touchdown. And it pulls the horns back to within one of Alabama. Up and it is no good, and they missed it. Wow, you can hear the air coming out of Texas Memorial Stadium as the horns miss a 20-yarder.
coach 10-10 at the half thanks to a big play in special teams.
Yeah, well, not just that. I mean, we had them in great field position, and we let them go 2 minutes before the half and make a couple big plays, or they were just going to run out the clock. So we put ourselves in that situation where they had an opportunity to score. But again, you know, Will made a great, you know, getting his hand on the field goal that, you know, didn't give him 3 points before the half, which was huge from a momentum standpoint. From my standpoint.
All right, Coach, we've got more coming up. Stay with us. 10-10 at the half here on the Nick Saban Show. Coach, 10-10 game at the break. What was your message at halftime?
Well, you know, what I really told the players is that, you know, when you're playing an atmosphere like this and you're playing games like this, you got to focus on what's in front of you. If you're an offensive lineman, you got to block the guy you're supposed to block. If you're a receiver, you got to beat the guy you're supposed to beat. If you're a quarterback, you got to take what they give you. If you're a defensive lineman, you got to control your gap. You got to cover if you're in the secondary. So we weren't doing that. I mean, so we weren't doing that. So everybody had to check their whole card. And how bad do you want to win this game? What does it mean to you? Right, because after the next 30 minutes, you ain't never getting it back. All right, so we need to go out there and compete and play a lot better in the second half.
Let's take a look at those second half highlights.
Is up and good, and on the 33-yard field goal, it is indeed. In motion to near side, play action to Johnson. They'll look for Card. He's going back. He's going down. Big hit delivered on Alabama defensively by Spotter. Good. The kick is up. And after he had the first kick, we saw later partially blocked. Goes to Young. Looking. Man is there. Catch is made. First down, Alabama. As spinning inside the 25, Ja'Cory Brooks, the sophomore from Miami. This is six. Empty set again. Young, pump fake. Looks to his left, rolls to his left, stops, looks, into the end zone. Catch is made. Touchdown, Alabama. Jahmyr Gibbs makes the grab in the back of the end zone, and Alabama has tied it up. Snap, handoff, goes to Gibbs. First down, Alabama, or very, very close. Depends on the spot. They'll review this one, I'm sure. Is up, and the kick is good, and Texas has taken a 19-17 lead with a minute 29 to go. Of Young, Bryce looking, throwing, catch made across the midfield stripe, down to the 46-yard line. Jahmyr Gibbs making the catch. Right of Young, blitz coming right side, steps through it, rolls to his right, directing traffic, runs it now inside the 25, gets out of bounds inside the 20. What a play. Bryce Young maybe saving a chance for Alabama right there. Avoiding 33 yards, snap, spot, kick, all up, and good! Will Reichard boots it through with 10 seconds to go, and Bama leads it 20-19. Step up, he will throw across the middle. Robinson catches it on his shoe tops. The clock says triple zeros, and let's get out of Dodge. 20-19. Alabama comes from behind late to win it.
Coach, your team finds a way to get it done in a 2019 victory.
Well, we didn't play the way we wanted to play, and there's a lot of things we need to improve on. How our players respond to that will obviously be really important this week. But you got to give our players a lot of credit for the resiliency that they showed to make the plays they needed to make at the end of the game to win the game. And, you know, tough game, tough place to play. Texas has a good team, better than people think, but we have to play better.
2019, the final. We've got more coming up, though, right here on the Nick Saban Show. Coach, it was pretty late before we got to it, but we got that turning point in the ball game.
Well, the turning point is Will gets a sack, you know, almost gets them out of field goal range. They make a field goal. We called a couple timeouts, so we'd have enough time to go 2 minutes. And the 2 minute drive that we made to get ourselves in field goal range, and Will making the kick, game winner, that's the turning point.
Big play, obviously, indeed, Coach. Big part of your coaching staff. Joe Cox coming on board, works with your tight ends. Tell us about him.
Yeah, Joe's a bright guy. I really like Joe. He's very smart. He's a quarterback, you know, in his college days. And he sees the game from a big picture standpoint. He's a good teacher. Very good worker. I love the guy. He's a young guy, and I like those kind of guys on our staff so they can develop into being coordinators someday, which I think he will be.
Coach, let's go Mercedes-Benz All Access with Joe Cox.
Take the foot pad off. All right, and remember on this, this is not a slide step trying to get.
I grew up in Charlotte, North Carolina, played high school football at Independence High School. And then went from there to the University of Georgia. And playing quarterback at Georgia was a great experience for me. Was always kind of one of my dream schools growing up, and having the opportunity to go there and ultimately play. Didn't know if that was ever going to happen when a guy named Matthew Stafford came. So I hung out on the bench for a while and got to watch a really good player play, and was fortunate enough to have 1 year to get out there and do it. And it was something that was great for me. So while I was in school, I always thought I was going to coach. That was dead set on getting into it right when I graduated, and kind of right towards the end of my career, I said, you know what, I think I'm just going to want to be a normal guy. And the further and further I got away from football, the more I realized how much I was missing it, and finally had an opportunity to volunteer at a school, and knew immediately that that's what I should have done all along. And ended up moving up to Charlotte, North Carolina, and coaching at a high school there called Mallard Creek. As far as mentors go for me, I've had a ton of amazing ones. Number one is my dad. You know, he was a football player, taught me how to do everything with every sport I ever played. The opportunity to come here is something that you always dream of as a coach. You want to be around the best coaching staff. You want to be able to coach the best against the best every single week. Just being a part of Coach Saban's staff, you know, everybody asks me, you know, what's it like? And the way that he leads this program and the expectations that he has of really everybody that's involved, whether it be an equipment manager, a trainer, a coach, a player, he demands excellence. He holds everybody to that standard. He's gonna make sure that you're accountable for what he expects for his program, and it's been unbelievable to watch. You know, my philosophy is making sure that, you know, guys in my room understand that it's way deeper than the game of football. I don't think, you know, you can be an effective coach without having a really good relationship with the guys that you see every day. And really just, you know, from a relationship standpoint, the type of impact that you can have on these guys, not just with X's and O's, is really, really important to me. My wife, I actually met when I was in college. She was a cheerleader at Georgia, and we ended up getting engaged when I was coaching out at Colorado State. We have a 4-year-old daughter named Avery, and last year we were blessed to have two twin boys, Jace and Tate. So we've been busy, unbelievable family at home. My wife is a football girl. She's awesome, you know, just in terms of understanding what my schedule is and the demands that this job has. And it really makes time at home that much more special, because you know that she's probably my biggest fan. To the fans, I would just like to say, you know, this is your program, and I want to make sure that I do my part to make you as proud as you've ever been as an Alabama fan. And we're working every day to do that, and we're going to make sure that we put something on the field that the Tide fans can be proud of.
Coach, time for our player spotlight, and this week it shines on one of your great linebackers, Henry To'oto'o.
Henry is I can't say enough good things about Henry. I just love the guy. I mean, he's a great leader. He's a good player. He's instinctive. Makes all the calls on defense, helps everybody else play better. I can't say enough good things about him. He's a great person. He has a great family. I love the guy.
Let's hear from the linebacker from Sacramento, California, Henry To'oto.
Henry To'oto, Sacramento, California, and I play middle linebacker. I chose to come to Alabama because definitely the culture and what's been set here and the guys that came before me. So definitely wanted to, you know, carry on that legacy and play for the greatest coach of all time and, you know, test who I am as a man and be able to play for Coach Saban and, you know, be a part of his legacy.
Henry To'oto takes him down. Another sack. The fourth of the ball, but this time it works for Henry To'oto.
I really want to be an agent, being able to, you know, negotiate contracts and stuff like that. I mean, I look up to guys in the NFL that can negotiate their own contracts so they don't have to pay nobody, save me some money. So that's definitely a goal of mine, to be able to, you know, help out my, you know, younger siblings, you know, my cousins, my family members, my friends, when it's their opportunity, no matter what field of sport it's in, to be able to help them in that way. I started playing when I was really, really young. You know, football has always been a love of mine, and crazy story is my football was a way of education for me and my family. You know, my mom and dad told us that football is going to get us the education that we need to succeed in life, and we're going to use that opportunity. But I knew I loved football since I was young. You know, my dad played football, all my uncles played football, so it was kind of inherited
right
in my family.
Of the line. Here now again, the inside give and an arm tackle, but this time it works for Henry To'oto.
Yeah, Lucky 11s is definitely, so I grew up in a household. My immediate family's 10, but we had, you know, always, you know, my cousin staying with us, my cousin Nanu, my brother Elvis always staying with us. So there was 11 of us in that household. So, you know, being able to have my family with me all the time, you know, I play for them and I want them always there with me, no matter if they're at the game or not. They're a piece to my puzzle. And, you know, without them, you know, it wouldn't be Henry and it wouldn't be who I am. So, you know, when I'm on TV or when I'm doing something, it's not just me. I'm trying to represent my family. To the Alabama fans, you know, we truly appreciate you. I truly appreciate you. You know, we appreciate your support, your love, and that passion that you have for us. You know, we're excited to see you guys all at Bryant-Denny Stadium every single Saturday. And we're looking forward to this season. Roll Tide.
Coach, time for us to take a look at what's next, and what's next is the team that Texas actually faced prior to you. That's Terry Bowden's Louisiana Monroe squad.
Yeah, well, you know, I think the big thing for us is we got to get ourselves right. I don't care who we play next week, no disrespect to, you know, Louisiana Monroe, but, you know, we need to execute better, we need to practice better, we need to prepare better, we need to be able to go out and do what we do a little better than what we did it today. If we're going to, we got to make improvement if we're going to be the kind of team that we're capable of.
We look forward to seeing you next week. Thank you for the time as always, Coach. Thanks for joining us after the Tide wins 20-19 over Texas. We'll see you next time on the Nick Saban Show, presented by Truckworks.
The Nick Saban Show is brought to you by Coke, with zero sugar and refreshingly delicious. Is Coca-Cola Zero Sugar the best Coke ever? Find out for yourself. And by the University of Alabama, where legends are made. And by Trustmark, people you trust, advice that works.